have our expert, Sandeep. He was also an alumni of NITR, so I am proud to introduce him. He is our student. He had worked with power electronics. He had done the hardware with both Arduino and FPGA. So I why he worked with both is he actually worked with FPGA with us. He made a five-level three-phase multi-level inverter with for solar application, and very beautifully he had delivered his thesis also. But the problem was he did it at his institute with FPGA, and we said you have to come and show your hardware here also. So he brought the hardware. The problem was FPGA they didn't give him from his college. So I thought we thought no, you have to do it here. So then he went for Arduino. He took the Arduino Mega and Arduino Mega, the same system, he again reproduced it here and he got almost similar results.
Yes, ma'am.
So that's why he learned to both FPGA and Arduino, and that surprise was how the FPGA gave a result, almost similar result. He got it here because his application was only 50 hertz output. It was not high switching frequency. When he would have gone for high switching frequency, there would have been a difference between FPGA and Arduino. So that's why I thought, let me call him itself. So because he will be a right person to give you difference about Arduino and FPGA connection for power electronics with renewable energy application. So once again, I just introduce to all the audience at the Nodal Center also, we have Sandeep. He is assistant professor in the ECE department at Bharat Institute of Technology, Meerut. And he's an expert in this area. And I think he'll be a right person to give you all the hardwares. He can just give you what are the hardwares involved in it. Because every power electronics device, as I already told you, it requires proper isolation. So, and driver ICs or driver circuits are also required. So he can give you an insight details about what are the ICs and what are the optocouplers or the driver ICs used here. And you can just interact with him and get more details. Okay, so because he is very good in hardware. And I just hand over the session to Sandeep. And Sandeep, first of all, he'll be giving you insight about his Arduino also. Okay, he has brought the hardware. He will give you the basics of how to connect. You're just going into the basics, yes, also, no? So he will give you, and then he will give you his application. Okay, so thank you, Sandeep, for coming all the way.
Thank you.
And I just hand over the session to you.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Center, mm-hmm. Center to our center. Today, we are going to discuss some applications which are related to some solar power-based multi-level inverters. First of all, we should have some glimpse about that why we use solar energy, because we have an abundant nature and we can use this energy very efficiently. So for that purpose, we have to somewhere include our power electrons, because the energy which we get, it is in the form of DC, but it is in the form of some variable thing. That means that it changes according to sun intensity. Whenever the sun intensity changes, the power will change. So we have some device which can stabilize this power, or we can say stabilize this voltage, so that we can use our DC load for connecting to that. After this, we have some application of inverters, because most of us are very used to for AC power, because we cannot replace all our DC loads with our from our AC load. So we have to make some arrangement so that we can use our AC load as well as our DC load also. As we know that LEDs light are coming, DC fan are coming, but it is not up to some level. We cannot completely eliminate the AC power. So we have some arrangement that we can produce the AC power from the DC power that comes in the picture of power electronics. Power electronics works in the both field. It also gives our DC to DC converter output, like fixed DC to DC output, and as well as to convert the AC, we need an inverter circuit. As we know that inverter basically a simple DC power electronic circuit in which we convert the DC power to AC power with the help of some techniques. And the second thing is that the main concern in the inverter, we consider about the TSD, harmonic contents. Whenever the harmonic contents is large, it is the power is just, we can say it is not useful, it is polluted power. So we have also considered that how we can limit or we can minimize the TSD content. So it is our main purpose. For that, we have to reduce the number of switches, as well as we have to reduce number of DC sources, so that we can eliminate our some component and we can produce some more efficient results. So after that, we should also know about that the AC power, three-phase power is always better than the single phase power, because whenever we talk about harmonics, there is always triple and harmonics in the single phase power. But in case of three-phase power, what we see, the triple and harmonics always eliminated itself. So we have just a few harmonics left, because all even harmonics are already dead in AC power. So we have some specific, we can say that harmonics, that's fifth harmony, seventh harmonics, by using some technique, some selective harmonic elimination technique, or we can say some multi-level inverter technique, we can also eliminate that. For higher order filters, harmonics, what we use some filters. For that purpose, we can use filters, so our problem may be solved. So first of all, we will go for the basic introduction of inverter. As we see, there is a hybrid inverter and a single phase full bridge inverter. This is a basic form of inverter. If we talk about three phase inverter, we have a simple diagram of three phase inverter. Now we are just going to introduce you that how we can do research on this topic and how we produce some new type of inverters. Moreover, we have a small introduction about harmonics, that what is harmonics. It is basically a multiplants of sinusoidal waves, and it is very harmful for our equipments, because it produces different type of problems over there. We have some techniques, like we have some PWM technique, we use different type of PWM technique, even we use some multi-level techniques. It is also quoted from the literature that multi-level inverters are really very useful and gaining very popularity in nowadays. So we will going to talk about multi-level inverter, basically a cascade multi-level inverters. We have some objective for today work that I have categorized in the three points, that how we can minimize our number of switches so that we can minimize the number of our transitions which are going to happen in our inverter application. Because if the number of switches in the number of switching will increase, automatically the distortion will also increase. So we have to just focus one thing, that we should have a number of switches, we should be very less number of switches. So first, it is our first objective. Second one, we also should have some techniques so that we can eliminate some DC sources, because the number of DC sources increases, the again some problem also increases also. Because always if we talk about solar power panel, we need a DC to DC converter associated with that. So cost will increase, as well as the different circuitry also will involve, and different circuitry will need to accommodate that. So this is our second objective. Now the third, which is main, we should have some lowest TSG content. So according to these three criteria, we have tried to make some new type of inverter so that we can do some research, or as well as we can produce some output which is less harmonic content. For this purpose, I have taken some examples from some research previous. There is a cascade multi-level inverter, which is a five-level inverter. Here we see that there is a two DC source and there is a total number of eight switches in a single phase. If we make it a three-phase supply, then the total number of switches will be 24 and DC source will be six. It's a simple cascade multi-level inverter, which is of five-level inverter. It's a basic configuration of your previous one. We have this one, the basic full bridge inverter. We have just modified it in the form of some multi-level inverter. This just in cascading the form. So by the help of this connection, we can produce five-level of inverter. Three-level of inverter, basically a sinusoid modified inverter, which is basically a simple inverter in which we produce output with the help of some firing angle, changes some firing angle. So it will make three-level inverter, but for five-level inverter, we have to connect two full bridge inverter into the cascade form. So this is a basic form of cascade multi-level inverter. It's a basically starting from here. Now we have second configuration in which the researcher has, scholars have produced a different type of configuration in which we have again a two DC sources, but again there is a six number of switches. So we can calculate that the total number of switches for same level, that is five level, we need total number of switches 18 and DC sources will be six. Now with the help of this configuration, we have some extent reduce our switches. because in the previous there were 24, now it is 18 switches. But it is also called the CCS MLI, that means cross connected source based multi-level inverter. It's a basically a very popular inverter, and lots of people work on this, and it is also a, it would also give a better results. So next we have another type of configuration in which we can produce a 5 level output with the help of some bidirectional switches. Here you can see the Q5 is a bidirectional switch. It's a bidirectional switch. You can see with the help of some diode connection, we can communicate this switch in either direction, in forward or as well as in reverse direction. So by the help of introducing these switches, we also reduce some number of switches. Now the number of switches are 15, and DC sources is always again 6 over there. Now we can see this diode based MOSFET, or we can say the bidirectional switches are now available in the market, and we can go for that. We no need to do some diode configuration over there. So it is basically a simple diagram. Now if I'm going to move some next level of configuration, that I have just compared some full bridge inverter to your next, which we have taken that minimum number of switches now till now is 15. So by the help of this full bridge inverter, we have made this inverter. Now if we have a three-phase inverter, we can also introduce this type of concept in our three-phase inverter. So by introducing this arm into all three arms, we can produce some type of AC output, which is again of three level. It will produce you five level, it will produce you three level of output in the form of AC, three-phase power. So I have just used this connect, this type of configuration to make our new type of three-phase inverter, which is has a very less number of switches as well as some DC sources. Till now we have minimized the number of switches as well as the number of DC sources are basically all equal. But in next configuration we are going to see, we have just used this concept to make a new type of inverter in which the switches is again 15, but DC sources have been reduced to basically there are 4 DC sources in this type of configuration. So we can see it's a new type of multi-level inverter, which is basically a 5 level inverter which have 15 switches and number of sources has been reduced to 4. We are going to understand that how we implement this type of prototype. We basically did do some experiment with the help of some MATLAB. After that we did some experiment with the Arduino for implementation purpose. We also did some experiment with the help of FPGA. So in the present lecture we are going to see that how we made it and how we can use it for our AC power applications. So it is a basic type of our three-phase multi-level inverter. There is some operating principle, or we can say some operating modes. There will be 24 modes in this type of inverter, and one of mode is there. There is a switching scheme in which we can switch all these MOSFET according to the our required output. In the first switch mode, what we will do, we will on these three switches and we will get this type of output. VAN, BN is equal to 0. There is a load node voltage, and VCN will be of 4 VS. In a broad category, I will show you the particularly this type of table. In this table, you can see there is a total 25 time period. Basically T1 and T5 makes a one time period. So basically there are 24 type of intervals, or we can say 24 operating modes in this type of inverter. There are two conduction angles, we can say alpha 1 and alpha 2. There will be two conduction angles, alpha 1 and alpha 2. For more number of angles, we have to do some more type of calculation. Basically what we did, we did experiment with the help of some equal number of angles, as well as with the help of some different angles. By the help of some Newton-Raphson method, we can produce this type of different results, or we can produce different type of angles. You may get different angles and do some experiment on that. We have obtained two type of angle, that one 14 degree and 16 degree, which produce some type of 9% of TSG. by the help of some new techniques, we can also calculate different type of alpha 1 and alpha 2 and also alpha 3 and alpha 4. But it will basically increase the complexity of our circuit. So for simplicity, what we make an experiment with the help of same equal number of equal angles, and after that we produce two different angles, 14 degree and 16 degree. We will show that. In this figure, you can see that how we can switch this. It's basically a tedious process to understand, but it is very easy if we understand. There is a three switches which will be on at one time, at one time period, and we will see there will be a different type of our output. VAB, BC and CE, our line voltage. Basically, we concern about our line voltages. These are the line to node voltages. So we basically concern about 0 to minus 4S and 4S. If we compare, it will give you 5 level of your output voltage. In the figure of this waveform, we can see this is a switching diagram. Basically, all type of inverters can easily be explained with the help of this switching type of diagram. Any wherever you will find a circuit, you will find a switching diagram. And by the help of this switching diagram, we can write our program. This is our main concern about writing the program, how we can write. So in this switching diagram, we can see that all three switches are on. After that, T2, there is one switch is on, and there is Q4 and Q5 is on. So if we want to reproduce some results from some research papers, what we can do, we can have some switching diagram, and we can, with the help of some simple programming technique, we can write our own program with the help of this switching diagram. So I also did the same thing. How I will do, I will explain in this lecture. This is our output waveform in the phase of three phase. It is basically a node voltage, AN, and this is our main line voltage. It is of 5 level. So for increasing of levels, we have to just increase our one DC source and as well as some three type of some bidirectional switches. This is our waveform. Now the TSD, for TSD calculation, what we did, we have calculated the VRMS and we have also calculated some fundamental frequencies. After making some calculations, we derive expression like this one. So our main objective, we can say the performance index is like that. We have to find the minimum TSD with the help of some alpha and beta. I have put over here alpha and beta. So wherever we will get a less number, we will get a less TSD, we will take that alpha and beta. And this will be done with the help of some Newton-Raphson method. We have did with the help of that method in the form of MATLAB. After that, we find two results. This is our Simulink diagram in which we have produced our output. There is all the connections which are going to show that how we can connect our inverter with the help of some DC supply. Right now we are using some DC battery, but in the coming picture you will see that how we can use some solar power over there. For that purpose, we have to connect a DC to DC converter over there. After that, we will connect our inverter. So it's a basic configuration in which there are four DC sources, multiple inverters, and we have some switching pulses. The switching which are going to produce, there will be 15 different pulses which will be produced with the help of these two blocks. We have written a code, we have written a make a simple diagram with the help of pulses, with the help of some pulses of Simulink to produce some this type of waveform. So this will be responsible for that. After that, we also have used some LC filters so that we can minimize our higher order harmonics. After utilizing this concept, we have gained 3% of TSD after using this filter, because it reduced the higher order harmonics. Okay, this is our waveform which we have gained from our MATLAB Simulink diagram. It's a node voltage. Basically, we are concerned about this type of voltage. It's a line-to-line voltage. It is of 5 level, and we can see that there were two, three types of waveform are black and blue and red. And there is a phase voltages. Whenever we talk about three-phase power supply, we see the line voltage is if 5 level, then the phase voltage will be of 9 level. Basically in the form of three phase, it happens in like this, you know. Now next, we have seen that we have a TSD which we have produced over there. It's a 9%, and with the help of we have a different TSD with the help of some line voltage and phase voltage also. So we also have comparison like this. This is our filter configuration which I have shown you earlier. In this, after that, we will get 3% of TSD whenever we use some LC filter over there. If we don't use LC filter, we also focus on our changes of alpha 1 and alpha 2. So for that purpose, we don't need of this LC filter. But higher order harmonics can easily be eliminated by this, so we use this type of filter. Okay, this is our AC waveform. Now we are going to move apply this inverter to some type of DC to DC, we can say some solar applications. For that purpose, we have to produce a DC to DC power because we need a suffix DC output voltage, because in the battery we have 12 volt. So we also need a 12 volt, because in the form of solar energy we get some 21 volt, sometimes we get 20 volt, sometimes we get 19 volt. So we have to some fix about this voltage. For that purpose, we need a DC to DC converter. For that reason, we have a DC to DC converter simulated over here. After that, what we did, simulate our solar power panels, which I have used 36 watt of solar panels. We have used four panels which are of 36 of watt. So we simulated in the form of MATLAB, and we made a diagram with the help of predefined cell over there in MATLAB. There is a predefined cell. We can connect them in a type of series or parallel connection, and we can produce just like our real time of your solar power panels. So it's very easy method, because rather than to go for equation based method, but it is available in the MATLAB. There is a block of solar cell. We can connect them series and we can connect them parallel, and we can make a new type of solar panels. For that purpose, we have did this experiment, and we have connected 36 solar cells, six in parallel, six in series, basically which comes in 36 of solar power panels. It's a Vikram type of solar power panel. After that, we produce our characteristics with the help of MATLAB to just validate our results, so that we can be sure that we are going to do some right type of experiment. So we did this type of analysis to produce some PVI characteristics to match with the given data sheet from this solar power panels. So by the help of this circuit, we can produce our IVV characteristics, because before we go for experiment, we have to produce our equivalent DC model of equivalent simulink model of your solar power panels, because we are going to just analyze with the help of our simulink diagram. So for that purpose, we have done this. After that, we have to implement some type of MPPT technique, because we are going to also increase the power with the help of MPPT techniques. So here we have used a Piendo method, and it's a simulink diagram of Piendo method. You can also do this with the help of some coding technique. We have some code with the help of MATLAB function. We can call them that function, and we can also do with the help of some simulink diagram. It is very equal for this purpose. So we have used a simulink diagram to produce the MPPT technique that was a Piendo. Okay, now here you can see the power is just going to fluctuate, because it's a Piendo method. It is not a very accurate method. It's a basic method of MPPT technique. So it produces fluctuating in your output power, but it for our application, it can work. Okay, so we didn't go in depth of MPPT techniques. We just take MPPT techniques so that we can go on our experiment. Next. This diagram is show that there is a fixed intensity. We have assumed that the intensity is time of fix, and this is a solar power panels, four solar power panels, and there is a DC to DC converter. Basically, it is not visible to you, but I can explain. It's a block of PWM. This one, it is producing that it is a V and it is I. It is producing the your delta D, that is that will be given to your DC to DC converter. Basically, it's a MPPT technique block. In this, what we will do, we will write our code, and it will behave like your controller. It will produce a D duty cycle, and it will go to your DC to DC converter. This is a DC to DC converter. After that, what we will do, we will connect our inverter, which we have shown in earlier case. Now in the form of this functionality, we will get a 12 volt over here, and we will do our experiment like this. So it's a complete diagram. Basically, it's a large diagram in MATLAB. So for copying paste, it becomes some blur. It's an output voltage which we have got with the help of some solar power panels and this. And you can see there is some disturbance over there, because all we know, the battery power is basically a pure power, and solar power is basically some we can say some polluted with the help of some MPPT techniques, because there is a fluctuation in that. So we can also visualize that there is also fluctuating in there, because it is not always stable in nature. So, but if we have some type of waveform, like 5 level of inverter waveform, because you can see there also there is some fluctuating over there. So it will also behave, because whenever we use solar panel, we have to do much more effort so that we can produce some DC power. Okay. Now we can see the TSG content in this, basically more than 10% whenever you use the solar power panels. Basically, we are using a modelized power, so we are getting this 10%. But if we use actual solar power panel, it will produce you more TSG. It's a practical aspect. This is our structure, that how we will do. We connect four solar power panels, which are of 36 watt. Specification was like that. It was solar Vikram solar power panels, and the specification always comes with the help of this data sheets. The maximum voltage power, voltage will be of 16 volt. The current will be of 2 ampere. Operating circuit voltage basically of 21 volt, and short circuit current is 2 volt, 2.55 ampere. Basically, these parameters are important whenever we do the type of our modeling of this solar power panels. So for that purpose, we need this type of specification, so that we can compare our simulating result with our real time of data sheets. So for that purpose, we need some specification. Basically, we concern about our VOC and ISC in whenever we ever connect our solar power panels, you know, in the simulating diagram. There is a NP, number of solar panels, one, and series there is 36 solar panels. So it gives our information that how we can produce our solar power panels modeling in simulating diagram. Okay. Now, for experiment setup, we have some type of equipment. Like for digital control, we have used FPGA Spartan 6 kit, which is the latest version of Xilinx. And we have a MOSFET like IRF also 840, which have a rating of 500 volt and 8 ampere. Okay, this was our MOSFET. Basically, it's a driving circuit for as well as for DC DC converter, as well as for our inverter application. We have used the same type of MOSFET over there. This is our driver IC, which is always connected to this MOSFET. It's a TC4426, or we can use MIC4428 also in replace of that. Basically, it's a combination of these MOSFET and driver IC, and because it have a near about same transition characteristics. Because whenever we talk about MOSFET, we have to consider the transition characteristics. That means turn on and turn off time. So it should match with our driver IC also. Because if there is a mismatching, then it may cause a problem, because the switching will affect our output also. So for that purpose, we tried our different type of MOSFET driver IC. But this TC4426 basically have a similar type of characteristics. Turn on and turn off time basically are just equal to our MOSFET, that was IRF 840. For all type of DC-DC converters and inverters, we have used this type of configuration. Basically, there is a current driver circuits. What we do in the MOSFET, MOSFET runs on a 12 volt and high current specification. But our controller basically generate 5 volt and basically 20 milliamperes. So it cannot drive a MOSFET directly. So we need a driver. Just like in the case of our DC motor, if we want to connect our microcontroller, we need a current driver IC over there, LM293D. So basically what it do a 5 volt conversion to our high level voltage. So we have to give this IC to 12 volt DC power. So basically what it will do, you will give a 5 volt signal with 20 milliampere, and it will produce a required voltage at 12 volt and required current to turn on our MOSFET or turn off our MOSFET. For that purpose, we need a driver IC over there. It's a very basic configuration and it is very useful, and we have tried a lot of circuits and it works very well. So we have find out this good combination over there.
So I have performed one experiment on step up chopper.
Yes.
Which is based on MOSFET.
Basically, it's a boost converter.
Provide the gate pulse to the MOSFET.
Okay.
We have over there combination of operational amplifiers.
Yes, yes.
I have a DC voltage.
Okay.
That is being clubbed with the operation number, series number of operational amplifiers.
Mm-hmm.
Then the required gate pulse is there to drive the MOSFET.
Yeah, it's so the same, because we need a, we are getting us everything is in small package. So we also need work on some reduced area so that we can produce less heat. So for that purpose, we in this one more thing I would like to tell you, in this IC we have two gate driver IC, so that we can control two MOSFET with the help of single MOSFET driver IC. Okay. Now we have used a inductor that was of 240 microhenry available in market in the form of 3 ampere. It is available in market and it's of 340 microhenry. We have used this one. I will show you a picture of that, that how we will use it. We have to use some external ADC because FPGA doesn't have inbuilt ADC. As a microcontroller have inbuilt ADC, FPGA don't have inbuilt anything inbuilt, and it doesn't have anything inbuilt. We have to interface with the help of some external devices. So over there, for that purpose, to convert our voltage or current, we need a A to D converter. Here we use a ADC0804, basically a successor approximation based ADC analog to digital converter IC, which behave like our A to D converter. And we interface this converter to our FPGA board, because FPGA board always take our digital input, or it produce digital output. Okay. Now we have a current sensor to analyze our what we are getting the current. For that purpose, we have a ACS714 current sensor, which is of 5 ampere rating, and it is from Next Robotics. It is easily available, and its graph shows that it's a basically a linear type of circuit. Its basic voltage is 2.5 volt. If it is getting 0 ampere current, and it will produce a 2.5 volt, and if the current increases linearly, the voltage will increase. Basically, it is a Hall effect type of current sensor. It converts your current into your voltage. Basically, it is a Hall effect current sensor. So it also works very well in the form of our circuit. We also tested this circuit with the help of Arduino circuit. So it's a good combination of your current sensor. There are other sensors also available, which are costly, or we can say according to your temperature range high, the range of your current sensor will high. Resistive load, we have used 22 ohm, which was 5 watt. It is also comes in market in the form of different voltage, and we have used a simple voltage that is of 5 watt, and it is of 22 ohm. For battery, we have used 12 volt and 1.3 ampere, which is just of your near about 300 rupees. It comes in market, and it is very useful in robotics application also. So this is our experimental setup equipment, which we have used in our experiment to produce our solar power inverter based circuit. Next, I would like to show you that how we connect our circuit to our solar power panels. In the solar power panels, we have a positive and negative terminal. What we do, we connect a positive terminal to ACS positive terminal and negative terminal to our circuit, because we have to connect our sensor in form of series combination. For that purpose, we have connected this one. Now the output will be like, there will be a pin like middle pin number 2. This pin produce our output voltage corresponding to your input current. Okay, we produce this. We have gone this. This signal goes to your LM358, which is working like your buffer circuit. Okay, so that we can do some impedance matching. There should be no problem, because sometime whenever we don't use this buffer circuit, the loading effect comes according to this type of circuit. So whenever we go for the ADC data sheet, it always prefer that to use your some buffer type of circuit before applying your real time input over there. So we have used this configuration and this circuit. Basically, this circuit comes from your data sheet of ADC0804. It is basically from there. It is mandatory to use. For voltage, we have used a 250 kilo ohm potentiometer, because here we are getting 20 volt, and we have to give our voltage to our ADC is just reducing in the form, because ADC get maximum 5 volt. So we have to reduce with the help of some potentiometer circuit. So here we use a potentiometer to reduce this incoming voltage to some level so that we can sense with the help of our ADC. Both the signal goes to our ADC, which are working in the free running mode, and here the it producing the digital value in form of 8 bit, and also it is producing the value in the form of 8 bit. Now these two 8 bit value will go to the FPGA board. After that, we have connected our DC to DC converter circuit. Over there we have a circuit diagram of our connection between the IRF840 and MIC4428 or 4426. Both are same. So for that purpose, what we will do, we will connect our pin number 1 to pin number 7. Pin number 2 will be of our source and 3 of your drain. Now the pin number 6 will have a two capacitor like 4.7 microfarad and 0.1 microfarad. It also comes from a data sheet that how we can connect our MOSFET driver IC with the help of some type of these capacitors. Because if we don't use this capacitor, it malfunction and it does not give our proper output. We have try some experiment without this, but it doesn't work well. So for this configuration, what we will need a MOSFET and we will need a driver IC and we will need a two type of capacitor over there. Now, whenever we apply a input from our FPGA pin or we can say microcontroller pin or we can say our DSP space board, we will just apply from there. And this driver, this MOSFET will drive accordingly. So it's a basic circuit. After that, we will connect our load. It may be a different type of load so that I have shown you a 22 ohm of load, our three phase load. Basically, it's a circuit for just checking our DC to DC converter working or not. Okay, this is a basic diagram of how we connect our hardware for that. It's very useful and we have also used our in research work also this circuit. The practical, sorry? Yes, it's all for microfarad. Actually, in the MIC4428 IC, there is capacitor are used for spikes removal as well as for some static purpose. If we don't use this, the datasheet shows that it will not behave properly because whenever we use some element, we should read our datasheet and whatever it suggests, we should use that component also with that. If we don't use, it will not behave properly because whenever they produce some element, they produce some constraint. According to that constraint, the element will work. Okay, so basically we didn't put the capacitor extra over there. It is come from our data sheet. So the data sheet explain that how, why they are using for that and what is the specimen which are meeting after using this one. Okay. So next we will move in the block diagram of this. We have just implemented with the help of our PCB board. This is our current sensor, which I have shown you, ACS714, the solar power panels wires over there. It's a ADC0804, two ADC are used. This is a potentiometer, which is used for voltage, just down the voltage, some level to ADC. And there is a test LEDs also. Because before giving to our FPGA board, we can also test our output that it is coming in right form or not. So with the help of this LED test LEDs, we can check that whatever the value is coming is right or not. Okay. So this is our basic circuit that how we can connect our four power panels to our any type of development board. Next, we have a DC to DC converter. It's a real picture of that. It's a MOSFET switches. And there is an output capacitor. This is an inductor which I am talking about. It's a 240 of microampere and 3 ampere of current microfarad. It's a MOSFET driver IC and we needed two capacitor over there. Okay, this is an input capacitor. So it's a simple diagram for your DC to DC converter. It's very compact and very useful. Okay, there is a different, there are two types of buck converter we have seen in the literature. There is a synchronous buck converter as there is a asynchronous buck converter. So basically what we do, if we replace our diode from our MOSFET, basically what it happens, whenever this MOSFET will work, it will be off. Whenever it will work, it will be off. It's a synchronous buck converter. It produces much more efficiency than our simple type of buck converter, wherever we use our diode. Because also diode like behave, whenever a MOSFET will work, diode will not work. If diode is working, MOSFET will not working. So for that purpose, we can use another type of MOSFET. It basically in the diode, what we see, there is a voltage drop. So for that purpose, we also get some less voltage over there. Next, there is a module. I have made this three-phase inverter in types of module. We have connected three pairs of our MOSFETs. So that we can recheck and we can give some test point over there, because in the MOSFET, in the case of MOSFET, it really get affected from any type of malfunction, and we have to replace over there. So for making a complete circuit, we have implemented in type of modular form. So it is like a modular inverter. We can replace our module and we can also add on our module. Okay, in the next figure I can show you. Here you can see. There is total 15 switches, which is in the form of three pairs. the three pair will be of your one leg of your circuit, and the all will make your 15 inverter, 15 type of multi-level inverter. So in the types of module, you can also replace your, you can add them to this circuit so that we can increase our levels. So for that functionality, I have used this type of configuration. Basically, the concept of modular inverter. In modular inverter, the odd modules are made in type of modules, and whenever you required, you can add your modules. This is our resistive load over there of 22 ohm, 5 volt, and we have four DC to DC converter over there, and we have an ADC module. This is our complete diagram, setup diagram, so that we can produce our AC power over there. Okay. Excuse me. Here you can see the there is a three MOSFET and there is a two driver IC. One driver IC is communicating with two MOSFET, and one pin is basically left for debugging type. Okay. So this is our main block diagram of our research work, that we have a solar power panels, DC to DC converters. After that, a DC bus. We can use super capacitor, or we can use DC to DC batteries. After that, we have a three-phase inverter, and we have a three-phase load. For controlling all these things, we have a FPGA board, or we can have a DSpace board, or we can have a Arduino board over there. So for that purpose, we have to write our code in this type of algorithm. If we use our Arduino board, we have to learn the C language. If we want to use a DSpace, we have to learn our MATLAB. If we want to use FPGA, we have to learn the Verilog. So whatever board you are going to use, you have to learn basically a type of language over there. So it's our block diagram, and it's a main diagram of our circuit. It's a complete setup. Here in this lab, we have set up the everything which is needed for this experiment. There is a digital oscillator which is producing your AC output. It's a computer with your Xilinx, and this is a Xilinx kit which I have used. It's a FPGA board which is of Spartan 6 family. So it's a latest version. So we can implement with the help of this complete setup. There's a three multimeters to show your output voltages. This is our some distorted output voltage because we are using the real time of solar power panels. So it is producing very, very fluctuating nature. But we have accumulated that we have gained a frequency of 49.77 hertz. Basically, it's a near about 50 hertz. So we have gained 49.77 hertz frequency with the help of some FPGA applications, and it's a real-time waveform from your solar power three-phase solar inverter. It's a solar-based type of waveform. Okay. So basically, we get this one. We have our TSD in the form of our we have a Fluke power analyzer. We measure our TSD content. Basically, it's a it comes whenever we go for simulating purpose, it is near about 9 to 10%, but I have also mentioned in the previous that it now it comes in the form of 20% in TSD form. So basically, whatever we do in some type of simulating diagram, we neglect some real time of effects. But in practically, what we do, if we do, there comes a 20% of TSD content. So basically, it's a experimental purpose. We have got these three results for 20%, and after that we have also did an analysis, like if we do the same angle, we have a TSD content of 12.55. it's a simulating results. Basically, we have a 12.55% if we use the same angle for conducting our three-phase inverter. If we use a different angle, as in my case I have used alpha and beta 15 degree, we will get a different results, like 10.06. it's based on solar based system. And if we use a LC filter, we will get a less number of TSD content. Okay, we didn't use a LC filter because for making that we need an external effort. So basically, we just shown you the work over till here, module number 2. We have just produced this result with the help of some simulating diagram. Okay, this is our some comparison between that. Okay, now this is all about our three-phase inverter, that how, what is the basic idea, that how, what work we are going to, which we I have done, and what we are going to do in the next few couple of years. Now the basic thing is that, which is you should know, the hardware implementation. Yes. Input supply 21 volt.
The power which we have achieved in 3 phase, how was the power quality of that?
Power quality basically measured with the help of TSG content.
Yes,
20% it was practically, yes. But in simulating form, it is just coming 22. Yes.
Real time
case, we have got 20% TSG. 20% TSG. For that purpose, we have to do some more analysis on the different aspects which we have, which we didn't consider in this type of formulation. For that purpose, we can do some also research on that. But it's a basically experiment type of system. Yes. It's a five level. I have shown you output. This is your output. So we move further now. We have a hardware implementation part, because whenever we do the research on inverters, we basically validate our results some hardware type of real. For hardware implementation, it's easy to make a hardware with the help of some connections, but it's very tough to make our programming effort very effective. For development boards, I have categorized in the 3 categories. Like, we have a different type of boards available in our laboratory for validation of this type of inverters. We have a DSpace board, which is basically a DSP boards which are included in our system, and which is always associated with our MATLAB. That means we cannot produce a, we can say, the standalone application with the help of that. Only research purpose, we can produce some results. We can do real-time applications, but we cannot implement it in the form of some product form. For that purpose, we have to go some microcontroller-based board or FPGA board. Microcontroller-based board has a 2 types of capability, that standalone application also can be made, as well as associated with MATLAB. You can communicate with MATLAB, or you can produce some product over there. So for that purpose, microcontroller is really very effective. As well as, if we concern about large production of, if we convert basically concern about large efficiency, we go for FPGA board. Basically, it reduces our cost, runtime cost, and also the efficiency of this base system will be very large. Because in the microcontroller based system, the problem is that there will be a crystal based system. That means there will be a 16 megahertz crystal which will produce your frequency. Okay, but in FPGA board, the crystal is near about 300 to 500 megahertz. That means you can produce a nanoseconds pulses over there. For that purpose, you can use FPGA board. Generally, what we see in the case of inverter application, the FPGA board are really very very popular in this category. But for using this, we have to understand the Xilinx. We have to understand our Verilog. For basic starting, you should go for microcontroller boards also. So we have a microcontroller board that is your Arduino, which is very effective and very cost effective solution, and you can just buy it from any online store, and you can implement in your basically a simple experiment basis lab. It's a experimental cost will be very less, and you can start your research over there. For that purpose, you can need an Arduino board. I have also over there some boards is with me. This is your Arduino Mega board, which I have used, and you can see over there. It is visible. It's a Arduino Mega board, and it's at a, it has 54 input output lines. In our case, we have used only 15 lines, but if we do some more analysis, some more research, we need a more number of pulses. For that purpose, we require this type of board. So it's a very cost effective board, and we can use this board also. Next, we have a Arduino Uno board. It is also a category of Arduino board, and we can see it's a less number of pins, but the same functionality which is in the form of your Arduino Mega. It also works like that. In the next category, we have a Arduino Nano board. This one, the size is reducing, but capability is again same. It's a surface mount technology. So it's an Arduino Nano board for small applications. It also have a 13 input output pins, like you know, but it's a very small size of type of system. Next, we have an Arduino Nano, Arduino Mini, which is just a minute version of this one also. So we have a different versions of Arduino board, and we, according to our need, we can use any type of board. if we want to use only a DC to DC converter, we need as only single one pulse. So we don't go for Arduino Mega Board. We will go for Arduino Mini because it's a very 200 rupees cost and we can produce a number of DC to DC converter. But for that purpose, you need a UART converter. This one. This is a UART converter for programming of this Arduino Mini. You need a this type of converter over there. Okay, there is a mini USB in this Arduino Nano board, and there is a UART cable, so we can communicate with our system also. Okay, so we are talking about development boards, DSpace, DSP boards, microcontroller based board, and FPGA boards. One by one, we will go from microcontroller to FPGA board. In this session, we are not going to discuss about our DSP boards. Okay. So I am going to just start your Arduino. Basically, Arduino is a name of a company which produce this type of boards, and it's a microcontroller based board which is used for your real time applications. Okay, in this board there are some digital input output pins which I have used Arduino Mega. There are 54 digital input output pins, 14 in for Uno. It's a basic comparison between the Uno and Arduino Mega. This part is of Uno board and this extra part is of your Arduino Mega board. Okay, we have different type of communication systems like serial I2C interconnect system, serial peripheral interface, interrupt lines, flash. Basically, we are basically more focused on our digital input output pins and PWM pins. For power electronics people, we need a PWM pulse or we need a digital input output pulse. We can use also we need an analog input also because we need a voltage and current in the form of analog. So we concern about analog pins. What is that? After that, output in the form of PWM if we use our DC to DC converter, and output will be in the form of digital high or low pulse. So we basically concern about this three type of category. Next, what we see, this is a basic diagram of your Arduino Mega board. In this diagram, we can see this is your digital pins, green line show. It's your I2C where the board is connected to your PC. This is your different type of digital input output pins, extra pins. This area connects the analog pins over there. And these are your power pins. It produces your 5 volt as well as 3.3 volt. Whenever we use some different type of circuits like Zigbee, or we can say some other circuits which behave on 3.3 volt, it will also give power for that. For external power supply, there is a ZEC, we can use that, and there is a USB interface to power up with the help of your PC. There is a transmitter receiver LED which blink whenever you download your program or you communicate with your serial port communication. There is an inbuilt LED, test LED, that is your 13 pin number. Okay. Now, we will go, we have to go some deep knowledge of your hardware which we are going to use in our experiment. So I have just noted down some more important points, like 54 digital input pins, output pins will be there. Out of 15 pin can be used as PWM outputs. So for PWM pulses, we need some PWM pins, which are in the form of your 54 digital pins. The 54 digital pins may say near about 15 pins can be used as PWM. It can be used as PWM as well as it can be used as digital input output ports according to your configuration. It behaves. There will be 16 input lines which will be called using the A0 to A15. In the programming, we use the A0, A1, A2, A3 to A15 to get your analog input. Okay. Another thing which is need to know that it's a 10-bit type of ADC. Success approximation based type of ADC is available in this microcontroller board. That is of 10-bit. The meaning of this, if you give your 5 volt, it will produce a 1024. That means it will give you the 10-bit output voltage, 10-bit number. So we have to map with the help of some map function. In this Arduino Mega board, there is one more interesting thing there, that there is a 4 UART function. That means there are 4 serial communication devices, serial 0, serial 1, serial 1, 2, and 3. So we have 4 serial communication. That means you can communicate three other communication peripheral interface with this your Arduino board. So in the Arduino, you know, there is only a single serial communication. Okay, there is a 16 megahertz crystal on chip. USB connection is over there. Power jack is over there. There is a ISP header for programming and a reset button switch. It's a basic architecture, we can say the hardware component of your Arduino maker board. Now we are going to see some more different features of Arduino maker board. If we go deep in Arduino maker board, we will see that Arduino maker board basically developed with the help of Atmega chip. That is a company from Atmel, and Atmega 2560 chip is inbuilt in this Arduino maker board. So all the functionality of that Arduino, we can say the Atmega 2560, we have to understand for that. There are different ports in your Arduino, which can be called with the help of name, as well as we can call with the help of their original name. If we talk about our Atmega 2560, there are some different ports, which I have noted down over here. The 54 digital input output pins basically defines like that. There will be a port A, port A0 to A7. There will be 8 pins, which are 8-bit bidirectional input or output. You can use as input or you can use as output as well. So there will be a port A. You can call with their name, or you can also call with the help of their pin number. The both functions are available. You can call with the help of the pin number or as well as their name. Okay. So there is a PA, PB, PC, PE, PH, PJ, and PL. This is very informative information for you, because whenever we do some large number of applications, because we have to use single bit, every single bit of our Arduino board. So we need to we have some specification that how we can control this bit. Okay, because if we are not going to send 8 bit to one port, we are going to send single pin to every pin. So we have to understand the which port is connected to your Arduino board. Now this need to assign your input or output. In whenever we will talk about board setup, we will see that pin mode is a function which defined it as input or output. We have to define that. In the case of analog input, we have 16 analog inputs, which are basically defined with the help of PF and PK. There is a port, 8-bit port, PF0 and PF7. These 8-bit port basically dedicated for your input for analog input. Okay. Or also you can use as IO also. The analog port, if you define it as a digital, it will behave like a digital. But if you don't assign is a digital, it will behave like your analog input also. Okay. So this has a both capability, analog as well as digital. Okay. So if we only works on digital input output based system, we have a 54 plus 16. Total number of is near about 70 digital input output pins we have, if we don't use our analog inputs. For analog inputs, we need not to define our in the pin mode. There is no need to define pin mode. There is only a single command that will be analog read command. It will automatically detect which pin you have connected. It will convert your signal to your digital information. Near about 100 to 200 microseconds it takes to convert your signal to your DC voltage or DC value. 15 PWM outputs. Basically, the pin number we are more concerned. Pin number 2, 3, 5 are your PWM output. I have noted down over there. These pins are your dedicated PWM output. If you connect your hardware with the help of this pin, it will produce your PWM output. These PWM output basically work with some timer operation, because if you know about PWM wave, there is a fixed time period for the wave goes, and if we put our value, it will compare with that, and accordingly the output width will be changed. Okay, so the fixed time period will be saved in your this timer also. So SOD timers are like this. Pin number 4 and 13 are SOD with timer number 0, and 4, 15, 16 are timer 5. Basically, in this Arduino Mega board, there are 6 timers, in which 2 are 8-bit, which I have shown you over here, and all are 16-bit. So we will get 2 different type of PWM output. There will be a different output, and this will be a different output. Okay. The by default is near about 970, and next one is your 470 near about hertz. In the 4 UART operation, we have a serial begin command, so that we can communicate with your PC or other system. Serial begin 1, 2, and 3. We have 4 UART command. And in the column of this speed, what we will write? We will write our baud rate. Okay, the different serial devices can works on different baud rate. So if we want to connect our PC, So we must have used your 960 baud rate because our system works on 960 baud rate. So for by default it is 960. You can change with your software also, but by default it is 960. So whenever you are going to connect your Arduino to your system, you should use 960 baud rate. Otherwise, you may use any type of baud rate according to your application. These are availability 300, 600, 1200, 24, 48, up to 115200. Okay. Whenever we use the Zigbee applications, whenever we use a wireless communication based system, because we need a higher data rate, where at that case we use this one, this data rate also. So it is it basically we have to define this baud rate over there. If we want to connect our high speed type of device, we have to connect it according to your pins. It is available in data sheet that where these pins are available.
In the bracket, speed is mentioned. You have to baud rate mentioned.
No, speed basically showing that baud rate is will be like this. You have to put this baud rate over there. Speed is equal to baud rate, and baud rate I like this. Okay. Now I am going. Sorry. Yes.
Market में जो available है वो किस range के हैं, कौन से level के हैं?
Inverters, inverter 5 level, 9 level, 12 level, everything is available. There is a different type of companies which are producing your inverter. Basically, we are working on research level. मार्केट में आपके बेसिकली दे बेसिकली सोल्ड द इन्वर्टर लाइक योर मॉडिफाइड साइन वेव इन्वर्टर प्योर साइन वेव इन्वर्टर बेसिकली दे आर डिफरेंट टेक्नोलॉजी दे आर पीडब्ल्यूएम बेस्ड टेक्नोलॉजी एंड दिस टेक्नोलॉजी बेसिकली डिफरेंट टेक्नोलॉजी इट्स अ मल्टी लेवल इन्वर्टर टेक्नोलॉजी बेसिकली यू सी द इन्वर्टर विच आर बेस्ड ऑन पीडब्ल्यूएम टाइप ऑफ टेक्निक्स यस यस मैक्सिमम दे आर पीडब्ल्यूएम बेस्ड सिस्टम So they are modified sine wave, or we can say pure sine wave, digital output, which we give. Basically, it is all our modified sine wave, and we can say the PWM based systems. Multiple inverters are going in form of some research type of area. They are available for lab, because in our laboratory, we have a three-phase multiple inverter, but it is not for commercial purpose, actually. Okay. So we move on further. We have a main concern in Arduino Mega that PWM output, because for power electronics people, the PWM is the core of your power electronics, because all near about 90% of power electronics works on PWM. If you know that how we can communicate our PWM signal, you can do anything with the help of your MOSFET circuits. So for that purpose, we have to understand that how we can change our board, change our PWM with the help of this Arduino Mega board. So for that purpose, you have to understand few basics. Things that the timer associated with your pins. I have told you there are two timers, 8-bit and four are 16-bit timers. The two timers, which are T0 and T1, basically we can change our PWM pulse frequency with the help of a register that is your TCCRNB register. This register is responsible for changing your PWM output. You can change your frequency, because in different application you need a different frequency for PWM. Because if you are using cyclo converter, you need a different frequency. If you are going to use a sine wave PWM inverter, you need a 50 hertz frequency. If you are using some type of different application, like in my case, you need a different PWM frequency. So for that purpose, you have to change the values according to this register. It's a register. There n is your number of your timer. If you put over 0, it will behave like your timer 0 register. If you it will put over 2, it will behave your two timer register. Okay, so we have to put a value in this register to change the board to change the PWM frequency. This is a notation of changing the TCCR to be NB register. Like whatever the value will be there, we will not change the value last of 3 bits. These 3 bits are responsible for changing our baud rate. How we can see in this diagram. Now just have a look. If we are going to use a timer 0, then the cycle length, which is predefined, is 256. The formula will be like this: clock divided by prescaler divided by pin mode. as we know, the clock is fixed 16 megahertz. PWM mode is always fixed 256, but we can change this 64 number. It's a prescaler value. This prescaler value depend upon your value, which is going to feed in your TCCR register. In the previous slide, I have shown in this also, you can see there is a setting over written over here. And in this case, you can see there is a 0x01. If we put 0x01, what we will get? We will get a frequency of 62550 Hertz. If we put over there 02, we will get 727812.5 frequency Hertz. If we put 03, we will get this frequency. If we put 4, we will get this frequency. Likewise, we will have a different frequency over according to this settings value. So for different application, you need a different type of PWM frequency. For that purpose, you should just go for this register and change its value according to your this table. Okay, it's a predefined table, and according to this, you can change your frequency. If you want a different frequency besides of this, you can go for timer 1 to timer 4 registers, timers, and there is also a same formula used. But the thing is that the prescaler will be changed as accordingly, but the value is 256, cycle length will be changed over here 510. The cycle length will be of 510. So if we put a different type of setting over there, we will get a different frequency. So we have a different range of frequency. Like if we put 01, we will get 31372.55 frequency. That means near about 31 kilohertz. It is 32 kilohertz. Basically, whenever we work on our DC to DC converter, we need a high frequency, because for high frequency we need a less value of your inductor. If your frequency is less, you need a high value of inductor, and if you have a large number of frequency, then you need a less value of your inductor. Basically, it correlate. So if we use a 62.55 kilohertz frequency, we need a less value of inductor, less valuable inverter in inductor, sorry. So this frequency is basically used for your DC to DC converter application very easily, because 10 to 100 kilohertz are the very good efficiency frequency for PWM wave for your DC to DC converter. In the accordingly, you can change frequency like this. For cyclo converter, you need a different frequency. For that, you can use this one. So according to your application, you can change your PWM, but it is in the form of limited form. You cannot go with very varying nature of your PWM. For that purpose, we need a different type of hardware. It's a basic limitation of Arduino board, which I have told you earlier, that it produces a 1 microsecond minimum delay, and PWM, there is a very limited options. We don't have a very large option over there. If you want to produce a very specific PWM wave, we should leave this Arduino board and we go for FPGA board, because in FPGA, we can do any type of PWM generation, or we can produce any type of your output waveform. So for power electronics people, they basically prefer your FPGA boards. But for small applications, or we can say from starting, we can use this board, and very easily you can start your work over there. Okay, so this is your PWM mode selection and how we can change your PWM. Otherwise, it is fixed on this number. 976 is your fixed PWM output, and here it will be 490 fixed output. On pin number, which I have shown you earlier, it will be your fixed. There will be no change. Okay. Fine. So now we are going to introduce you that how we are going to use this board via our software. That is your Arduino IDE. Okay. I think that you have some glimpse of this Arduino IDE software previously. You have an introduction over there, Ned. Arduino IDE. No, okay, we go for very starting. Basically, this is your basic block of your, we can say the main window of your software. The Arduino is a open source software, and it can be downloaded from your internet very easily. And this is your editor window. There is a file, edit, sketch, tools, and help. We can use these for writing our program. One by one, we can see. This area is your code area in which you write your code. Okay. Next. This is your info panel. Here the information comes. Like if you are compiling, it will return like the compiling your Arduino. If you have done compiling, it will write done compiling. it will see your, it will give your information about that. This is your compilation tab. Whenever you want to compile your system before implementing, you will just click over there. If you click over there, it will compile your code. In every type of system, we need a compiler to compile the errors. So this is basically a simple compiler. Whenever you click over there, it will compile. Also, it will produce a hex or we can say .ccp and .hex file for this type of your code, because every compiler does the same thing. It works like it removes the error, it show your error, or it also make your executable file. So this is done with the help of this tab over there. In the next tab, we have a upload button. If we click on this tab, the code which you have written over here will be burned to your Arduino megaboard. Okay. Now, this is your serial monitor. It is very useful whenever we do the debugging type of task. If we want to check that what analog value which you are getting from voltage sensor or current sensor, if you want to see before going to apply in your system, so you can just see with the help of this serial monitor. You will write a command like serial.begin, and whatever value you are getting from analog input, you can just put over there like serial.print, serial.print over there the value name. It will show you the value which you are getting in the form of your digital. Like if you are getting a 5 volt, it will show you 1023. If you are getting 2.5 volt, it will show you 512, something like that. So whatever value we are getting, we can easily read over there. So it's very basically very useful. In this Arduino IDE, I have told you it's an open source, and we have a different type of examples which is inbuilt in this. So we need not to worry about understanding this very seriously, because whenever we go for examples, there are lots of examples which are given over there. We can learn programming by ourselves. We need not to do for info tutorial or all other things. If we go for tools, we have to do something like whatever board you are going to use, you have to click on board and you have to select your board according to your need. In my case, just I have used Arduino Mega board, so I have to just click on Arduino Mega. If you are going to Arduino Uno, you have to click on Arduino Uno. Whenever you will click this, it will compile your code according to that board. Okay. Whenever we do this type of task, we must have ensure that we have selected our right board over there. So for that purpose, it is given. Now, serial port. The serial port, there will be a serial COM port which is assigned by your PC. Whenever you connect your hardware to your PC, it will assign a COM port over there. So the COM port which is comes from your device manager. If you want to check that which COM port is assigned by your system, go to device manager, see the devices, and in the COM and port, there will you will see that with the name like Arduino Mega, Arduino Uno, and the following there will be a COM port. Like COM port 3, COM port 4, COM port 5. In the present case, this system assigned this Arduino board like COM 3. So you have to just click on that. Okay. This is the mandatory thing whenever we're going to use our board with your PC to burn your program. Otherwise, there is no need to do. Okay. Next, this is a simple Arduino sketch. It's a simple structure. There is a two type of structure, like there will be a void setup and there will be a void loop. In the void setup loop, you will put your pin mode, you will put your serial begin, whatever code which is going to run once, that means pin configuration. In the other software, what we do, we just configure our system in the starting area. We configure our system like include, like pin mode set, whatever we do in that area. So this is a one time of code. That means you can configure your code with the help of this area. Like you want to make a pin number 13 as high, or we can say output. So you will write pin mode 13 output. So it will behave like output. And if you write pin mode 13 comma input, it will behave like input. Okay. If you want to use serial begin 0, so you will write serial dot begin. If you want to use serial begin 1, then you will write serial begin dot 1. Okay. So for that purpose, we use this setup area. The main area which is concerned for this purpose is void loop. In this, we write our main code, our main logic, what we are going to use. Okay. And now we start our session from Arduino programming. And this session will be based on two different aspects. Like we will talk about Arduino programming as well as we will go for next session for FPGA programming also. So from the start, we have a simple program. It's a simple program in which we are going to produce a PWM output with the help of a pin number 9, and we have an analog pin at pin number 3. You can understand, like, we have connected a potentiometer on this pin number 3, and we want to get output according to your analog value changes. Whenever we change our analog input, like potentiometer, we will get a different PWM output at pin number 9. We will not set any type of register over here, so it will give you the base frequency, which is of your 490 frequency. It will give you that basic frequency. It's a basic program for generating your PWM wave. So what will we have to do? We have to first define your input, like we want to use this pin number 9 as PWM output. So we will define like int PWM output is equal to 9. So whenever we will use pin number 9, we will write over only PWM output. We need not to worry about learning this number 9, 1 and 3. After that, we have assigned pin number 3 as analog pin. You can write this black letters any name, whatever you want to write. You can write potentiometer name value. You can write port value. So it will assign like pin number 3. Pin number 3 is your A3. A3 basically defined for analog input. In setup value, it's the only simple variable which we will use in further, where we will get your analog value. In the void setup, what we will use? We will use a serial blink, serial being serial dot begin 960. We will use for debugging purpose, because we are going to see this value on your serial monitor. Serial monitor will open like this, tools, and we will click over there, serial monitor. And when I will click over here, you will get your analog input. So we have to define your PWM as output, because we are going to use this pin number 9 as output. So we have to define like output PWM output is equal to output. These colorful letters are your predefined words, and these black letters which are user defined. In the void loop, what will we use? We will use a simple variable value val is equal to analog read. This is a command like analog read. This command read your analog value from your analog pin. So the analog pin is pin number 9. So whatever potentiometer is giving you analog input will be saved in your value variable. Now, I have already told you that it is an inbuilt 10-bit ADC. So it will give you a 1024 value. Okay. But for 8-bit conversion, we have to use a map function. Here is a map function which is inbuilt, which will convert your 1024 value to your 255 value. Because in the PWM output, we need a value according to 8-bit. Because we need a 0 to 255 value maximum in 8-bit form. But we are getting from 10-bit. So we have to map this 10 bit to your 8 bit with the help of this function map. Okay. So the value you are getting is 10 bit, and you are mapping this value to your 8 bit value, because we are just going to give this value to your directly analog write. That means at your output pin. You will write a different type of syntax like analog write PWM output comma value. That means this value, but which are coming from your analog input, will be used as your PWM output. So in PWM output, what will we get? You will get according to the width will be changed according to your potentiometer value. So that whatever your potentiometer value will be changed, this will give you a different output pulses. Here is a serial dot print command, which will print this value to your serial port. Okay, so it's a simple program of your PWM output generation. So with the help of this simple program, you can use any type of controlling your DC to DC converter, like buck converter, boost converter, buck boost, cuck converter, stepway converter. Any type of converter can be controlled with the help of simple configuration. Just you have to put your potential divider to output on this analog input pin. Okay, it's very easy type of programming. It's basically available in your examples format. Like if you go for file, there is an examples, and there are different type of algorithms are given over there. There is an analog output, read in analog input, analog read, calibration, fading. There are different examples over here. So all examples are inbuilt in your examples folder. Next. We have our main concern about three-phase inverter. So I am going to show that how we can utilize this board to make a three-phase inverter like five level. First of all, we have to go for some mathematics. Like, we have a two different angles, like alpha 1 and alpha 2. Okay, we have a alpha 1 is 14 degree. Yes. It's basically a depend on your number of voltage and number of switches. Basically, the people work on 11 level. Yes. You have to put more number of DC switches. You have to put number of switches, static switches, as well as your DC sources. So,
I mean, I want to know what is the impact of leveling.
Impact of leveling is the minimization of TSD.
Yes.
Yes. You, if you think a sine wave, it is in the form of some digital levels. If you put a more number of levels, it will more come across your sine wave.
Exactly. So I'm asking, what is the maximum level that has been attained in the research field
now? Maximum level, because
if you have been in this sector, so you will be at least knowing the facts and figures. What is the level?
Actually, I tell you what happens. Whenever we talk about levels, we go for a minimum of TSD. The TSD can be minimized as well as with the help of levels increasing, as well as your number of switching cycles, switching angles. So the researchers work on both the principles. They works on basically on 11 level.
Yeah, what is the sustainable
level? 11 level inverters, three phase. Yes, basically more and more work are going on 11 level inverters, because it is very it gives very less TSD without using any alpha corrections. So 11 level is more appropriate for three phase systems. Okay. So we go again for this calculation. Like, if we have a alpha 1 like 14 degree and alpha 2 like a 16 degree, it may be any degree which you want to take. Okay. Now we should understand that our one cycle convert, one cycle goes from 0 to 360 degree. Okay. That means 360 degree will be equal to your 50 hertz. 50 hertz time in, that means 20 millisecond. It is fundamental. 20 millisecond, we can say it's a 20,000 microseconds. Okay. Now, if we calculate, 1 degree is equal to 55.55 degree. 1 degree, sorry, it will be a microseconds. It's a wrong written over here. Let me recorrect it. It will be like it, microseconds. 1 degree will be of this microseconds. If we put 14 degree, it will give you 7.77.77 microseconds. If we put 16 degree, it will give you this second value. So that means we have to produce this type of delay for producing your output voltage. Now, what we did, we have a 15 different type of output. So we have connected to two ports. Like, we have used port number, port C, and we have used port A. In port C, we have connected like switches. S3B, Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5, Q6. These are the prime switches. And these are the bidirectional switches, which are written over here. So it is port A, 8 pins are connected, and other pins are connected on this. 37 pin is left, because we need only 15 switches. We have done this. Now, we have to set up these pins like your output. So what we will do, we will use a DDRC command. DDRC basically to set the direction of your resistor. Basically, all the ports are associated with the resistor, associated resistor, in which we have to put your value. You can use pin mode function, or you can use directly with the help of this functionality. So what we use? We use a DDRC is equal to DDRC or B. B stand for byte, and all are 1. That means all are working as your output port. So we have made port C and port A as your output port, input output. Sorry, only output ports or all are bit addressable. Fine, now. This is pin setup. Now we go for void loop. In void loop, you will see I have used these three notations, like these values are in degree. These values are in point of floating values. So I have used a float keyword over here. Float will be D7, D14 and D16. In the starting, I have told you I have divided the mode number T1 and T5 in two parts. So for that purpose, I have used a different D7, and D14 stand for 14 degree, and D16 stand for 16 degree. Okay, now port C output will be like this, and port A will be like this. How we will see this? You in the PPT. I have mentioned this switching diagram. According to this, you can see which switch should be on and which switch, switch should be off. In this case, all these switches S1 to S3B should be off. That means it should be at 0. And what will be 1? Q2, Q4 and Q5. So accordingly, we can put 1 and 0 in that format. Are you getting? So it's very easy. With the help of this timing diagram, you just see your timing diagram and put the value according to your timing diagram. So in this, what we see in your Arduino, there is your value written over here. Okay, now we have to provide us some delay. Near about, we have chosen 1 microsecond of delay. Why? Because whenever we do the switching of two associated MOSFET, if the both MOSFET are conducting the same phase, it may burn out your circuit. So we have a dead time between two MOSFETs turning on in upper bridge and lower bridge. So for that purpose, we have introduced a 1 microsecond of delay. Before one on and after will be off, there will be a 1 microsecond of delay for safety purpose. After that, we will put a second value, that is D16. According to table and according to switching diagram, we will put a delay and we will put your value accordingly. So by doing this, T1, T2, T3, T4, we can put all the switching values in this format. And this code is really very easy to implement any type of your switching diagram. So I have written this diagram for 24 modes, including your 25. 25 will be of your half mode. Half mode for we have used your D7 over here because it's just half of your starting angle. So with the help of this simple programming, we can implement our logic. Now you see, it's a very cumbersome to understand, to see that it's very, it may be a very complex, but for programming, it is very easy. You implement any type of switching angle table as well as your switching diagram to this programming language with the help of this code itself. Okay, it's clear. Now we move further. It's your switching diagram. Any switching diagram which you get from any proposed research paper, or if you want to produce your own switching diagram, then you can do this type of programming. And with the help of this technique, you can produce any type of your switching pulses. And delay will be according to your setting, which we have written over there. Okay, but you have to include your 1 second delay according to your 20 millisecond time period. So accordingly manage, because in this category, you see, these values will be of 77.77, which I have calculated earlier, but here I put 776.77 because 1 microsecond I have used here for like your delay, for dead time delay. Okay, so that should also be considered, because if we don't consider this, our overall frequency will increase and it may go above your 50 hertz. So we have to combine everything in your 20 millisecond span. Okay. Now, this is your most interesting thing, which I'm going to tell you, that if you want to implement our logic on your Arduino board, we need Arduino board, we need a complete circuitry, or we can say our full inverter, which is connected all the switches. But if we don't have a full circuitry, and if we may have some confusion that it will work or not, maybe some MOSFET is not working, maybe some connection is loose, so we will not get a proper output. So what we will use? We have to use something like in simulation purpose. Okay. So for that purpose, we have a library which can be included in your Proteus software. It's the most interesting thing, that if we don't have a hardware of your inverter physically, then we can create in your Proteus Simulink environment. In that area, we have to call our Arduino over there. How we can do that? Because in normal case, in the Proteus, there is no Arduino library. So manually, we have to put Arduino library into that Proteus software. How we can do that? We can download our Arduino library from your internet and from Google it. You can get very easily. Arduino library, as well as some other library also, GPS library is available, Zigbee library is available, all libraries are available on the internet and on Google. And for that purpose, what will you? You will use two files. If you download your folder, you will get two files, arduino.idx and .lib files. These two files should be copied to your library, which is will be in your C.program data. If you install your Proteus on your system, what you will see, there will be a program data folder which may be hidden. So please just unhide the all folders and go to your program data. There will be a folder like Lab Center Electronics, and there will be a folder of Proteus 8 Professional. And the library include all the library items which you are going to call in your Proteus environment. So for in that, you manually add these two files to your library. After that, whenever you will open your Proteus, you will see in the library that Arduino is over there. So it's a great thing. Then we can do our start our simulation purpose. Whatever file we are going to generate with the help of your Arduino IDE, we can directly put your hex code to the simulating environment, and we can use your simulation start. Okay, select your required Arduino board. I will show you that how it will happen and how we can do it. It's a simple process. It's not a very hard task to do this. Just download these two files and copy to your library, which I have given you a simple path. Okay. After this, we have to write your program. What is the procedure for that? I will tell you in next slide. This is the overall process. Like if we burn our program in LED program in your Arduino, what it will behave? It will blink your LED. Like in 1 second delay, it will blink your LED. Okay. Now the same thing we want to do in Simulink environment. Okay. That means we want this Arduino working as your Simulink item. How we will do? Open your Arduino IDE. Open the blinking program. Select your Arduino board. It is mandatory because it may give some problem if you don't do this. Let I have chosen Arduino Mega. Compile the program. Only you have to compile the program. You need not to have even a real-time hardware. There is no need of hardware. Any type of hardware you don't need. You just need your software over there. You need an Arduino IDE. You need a Proteus software, and you can do all type of simulation. How? We will compile your program. Only compile. Don't download it. After compilation, what will happen? It will create a hex file. It will not directly create your hex file to your folder. There is a path where we can get this hex file. How we will get this file? This hex file will be in the following path. Like in the C, we have a user account. User, we have a Dell. In my case, it is a Dell. In your case, you administrator may change. So go for that. After that, go for app data, local, temp, and there will be a folder like build. This number may be changed. Okay. But just see that when you compile your program, they will on that date, this folder will be created. If I create this folder on the present date, it will show me a 17th of March. Okay. So choose the folder which show you present date when you compile your program. When you double click on this folder, you will find your hex file over there. Okay. Now you have got your hex file path. What you have to do? You have to just open your Proteus software and select your new project. After this, its new circuit will be made, like LED connected to your pin number 13 with Arduino Mega board. Arduino Mega will be over there. Double click on the Arduino and open the hex file as mentioned above area. Whenever you will double click on your Arduino board, it will call your file, hex file. Just give the path which is given over here and simply run the simulation. I will show you a video in which you can see each step which has been done according to this program running. Okay. Here we have opened our Arduino IDE software. This is your blank sketch. In this blank sketch, what will you? You will open your examples, your blink program from your examples, in every software it is given, you will just open your blink program, and it will open your blink program like it will on and off a pin number 13 LED in 1 second delay. Okay, it's a simple program which is always used for testing your hardware. Even although we don't have a hardware, but we can use this type of practice. For that, you have to select a board, whatever board you are going to use.